around the airport area without parliamentary approval. And so we want to borrow into this a bit more and understand exactly what is happening and what Parliament is doing about the situation. And he joins us in the studio this morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning,
how are you doing?
I'm well. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well. You've become more like an investigative journalist at this point.
Really?
Quite a number of exposés.
Yes, and really, if you have to do your job very well as a member of parliament, the full understanding and appreciation of the constitutional mandate of oversight, that's really part of your mandate to delve into matters. Don't just sit back in parliament and wait for what is brought before you, because as we are finding out in a lot of these scandals, most of these things are going on the blind side of parliament. They don't seek parliamentary approval. They will not present it to you. You won't find it in annual reports. You won't find it in work plans. You will not find it in the budget approvals that they bring forth to parliament.
Okay.
So if you just sit in parliament and wait for documents before you interrogate, a lot is going to go amiss. And before you realize, so much harm has been caused.
Okay.
So my understanding of oversight, particularly financial oversight, checks and balances, making sure that the executive arm of government is really reined in and there's transparency and accountability, is that we must all go a step further, particularly as members of parliament, because really that's what the principle is about. I mean, those who propounded the theory is to make sure that, I mean, no arm of government becomes overbearing, because it will lead to tyranny, it will lead to autocracy and all of the attendant vices, which includes corruption, which includes state capture, which includes, you know, lutocracy and all of those, you know, ills and atrocities, if you like, which we all do not expect in a functioning democracy. So that's really my understanding of my work so far as oversight that is guaranteed under the 1992 constitution for members of parliament. So often I hear people say, oh, is he not taking the role of investigative journalist? Is he not stampeding their work? No, not at all. I'm only really carrying out my constitutional mandate and going to the next level. Probably we are used to all of us sitting back and waiting for the investigative journalists to bring these matters to the fore. But I think that we need to investigate these matters. All of us, we have that duty. And if you read the Constitution carefully, even beyond members of parliament, even citizens, why do we have the Whistleblowers Act, for example?
Yeah.
You know, all of us are enjoined, you know, to blow the whistle, to blow the alarm, and to bring these matters to the fore so that anytime there's wrongdoing, anytime state resources are being diverted, we can all be, you know, useful citizens, patriotic citizens that will stop, you know, the rot, the canker, and set this country on a good path.
How many pieces have you worked on so far? Because I remember the Frontiers Healthcare, you traveled all the way to the United States. This was just a few months ago. Now, prior to that, you had also hammered on the president's expenditure on travels. And even that, we had the defense minister come and say that, well, those are very high security matters, and so we cannot really give out those information like you were asking for. And a few others, of course, Reverend Kusi Abwating, that case is currently in court at the moment as well. So you've worked on how many so far?
I'll say about 10 major.
10?
10 major exposés. Remember the Oslo Chancery one? The foreign ministry was about to purchase a building in Oslo, Norway, for Chancery. And when I went through the documents they presented to us in Parliament, the figures clearly were on the high side. So I decided to go to Oslo undercover and see things for myself. It turns out that that is a building which had been sold a year earlier for just about $2.7 million. Then it was sold again to an unknown buyer for $3.5 million. And it was that unknown buyer who insisted on being secret. And under Norway law, you have that right if you don't want to, you know, disclose your identity and the parties in the transaction. And interestingly, that unknown buyer who had bought that building for $3.5 million was now selling it to Ghana for $12.2 million. Can you believe that? I mean, inflationary pricing of the most ridiculous kind, from $3.5 to about $12.2 million. So I had to blow the whistle. Certainly, the foreign minister was not too pleased. You remember there was some altercation in parliament, which I think was unfortunate. We have since, I think, mended matters, and I think they understand that I was only carrying out my mandate,
has particularly there been a finality on
as
that
ranking
matter?
Member on the Foreign Affairs Committee. So, fortunately, thanks to the expose, the ministry backed out of the transaction. It had to even go to court. The attorney general had to fly to Norway because the owner of the property was saying that, look, you had committed, we have signed all the paperwork, and why are you backing out? I don't really care about what your members of parliament are saying. And he went to court. But fortunately, the foreign ministry came up with a defense that those who were acting in Norway didn't have the full authorization of the minister here. And so the government was not really fully aware. So use that, you know, defense to secure a favorable judgment.
Okay.
So as we speak, thanks to that expose, we saved this country about $8 million. Then the second one, I'll run through quickly
because we have to get into the health.
You remember the presidential travel scandal, the luxury chartered jets. Ghana has a functioning presidential jet in pristine condition, mint condition, more or less. A jet that has nothing wrong with it. It had been ordered by President Kufuor. President Mills used it. President Mahama used it. Suddenly, President Akufo-Addo was not using it. And it was unknown to Parliament, unknown to the Ghanaian people. I had to make that discovery that apparently the jet had been parked, the Falcon 900EX, which is a long-range aircraft, had been parked, and the president had opted for very expensive 20,000 euros an hour ultra-luxury jets. Fortunately, after persistent exposés, the president has stopped.
Yeah.
I've monitored his last 7-8 travels. He's now back to using the presidential jet.
Okay.
Some say it's also because we run into a financial crisis. But I'm glad that, thanks to that expose, if the president had continued, I've done the analysis, if he had continued using the jet, but for my expose, the taxpayer would have lost over 150 million cedis. You know, then I can talk about the e-transaction levy services.
Yeah.
When e-levy was introduced in parliament, virtually unknown to all of us, they had come up with a scheme to have what they call revenue assurance. And everything was cooked. It was valued at 241.9 million Ghana cedis. Again, we had to expose that. And fortunately, that was removed. That was a cabinet decision after my expose that whole 241.9 million revenue assurance transaction, because that's something that the GRA could have done, or the Bank of Ghana, using their GIP systems, could have done. And there was no need to create, you know, that whole. So we saved 241 million.
For the sake of time, can we just go into the heaven scandal?
Let me just run through. Then you remember the almighty National Cathedral. Imagine if that project was continuing. Already on the blind side of Parliament, violation of the Constitution, 339 million Ghana cedis had been siphoned into that project. We now have the world's most expensive pit. Nothing to show for it. And I'm glad that some reverend ministers have resigned on principle and based on their conscience. Then Reverend Victor Kusibuati and the Kwabena Edujemfi double identity scandal. People only focus on the criminal conduct, but there's also the payments. If this scheme had not been discovered, you're seeing that he was sitting on the board and making payments to a company where he is director as Kwabena Edujemfi. He had made an initial 2.6 million cedis payment. So it's good that we uncovered that. Then there was a kitchen scandal, which was a Gabi Ochidakun West Blue Alliance, 187 million Ghana cedis, which we have stopped because in opposition, they said this deal was bloated. It didn't go through due process. You know, we didn't have value for money.
Okay.
And suddenly, Gabi Ochidakun was trying to demand 187 million, wrote several letters.
Was he demanding? That was a client.
Yes,
he was
his client. But he was
and
at
he
the
was
forefront.
The lawyer, exactly.
Yes, but he was at the forefront of the opposition, saying that, you know, this deal didn't guarantee value for money. And suddenly, he's saying that now, as lawyer for West Blue, that President Mahama didn't pay enough. So the double standards. And I'm glad that since the expose, they've all backed off. So we've saved 187 million. Then there's the Frimpong Boateng Apex Pollution dubious judgment debt, okay, which I exposed, $88.2 million. That also has been taken off the table.
Let's go to the Heaven scandal. So tell us about the Heaven scandal for those who may not have had time to read, because those were lengthy documents that you posted. There's a part one, part two, and part three.
Yes.
Tell us about it. What exactly is the Heaven scandal?
So basically, the Heaven scandal, and I call it the Heaven scandal because the company at the center of this Create, Loot and Share scheme is called Heaven Builders Limited. Mm-hmm. And take note of the penchant for these holy, you know, names. National Cathedral, we are going to build for God. And it turns out that, you know, don't have holy intentions. Now, you know, Heaven Builders, as if it's something.
Yeah, but you are linking enterprise. It as if to say that it's, you the know, same no, people
no,
behind it.
No, I mean, the point is how they really like to go for these, you know, supposedly holy.
Who are they?
You know, you'll get to know them soon. I mean, clearly they have collaborators in government. It's a whole state capture agenda. So Heaven Builders Company Limited has been offered initially 38.12 acres mm-hmm. of prime land belonging to the Ghana Airports Company Limited. Mm-hmm. And so that means that it's land for all of us. The Ghana Airport Company Limited is a public entity. They are only acting in trust on our behalf. So the land belongs to us. Now, this airport land, mm-hmm. we have about 93 acres left. And the plan has always been that there will be phase two. So you preserve them for further development. The airport started, remember, with Terminal 1. Mm-hmm. Then we added Terminal 2. Now we have Terminal 3, which continues to win a lot of international awards. If these lands had not been preserved, we would not have seen these expansions. So it's always important that when you are taking a strategic decision, mm-hmm. That will virtually, you know, undermine future expansion and all of that. These are matters that must be carefully considered, and there ought to be utmost transparency. The Ghanaian people must be involved because it's our land. Mm-hmm. It's land that we have, the state has done compulsory acquisition, taking it from your people, the Ghana people, who could have probably benefited, your family, elders, and all of that. They have, you know, generously decided that, look, for all of us, our national interests, we will give you this land. So it's important that what you acquire the land for, you maintain that use of it. The constitution is very clear about that. So I was really surprised when I intercepted this letter dated December 16, 2022, signed by Mrs. Pamela Jamson-Tete, the managing director of the Ghana Airport Company Limited, mm-hmm. which reads, offer allocation of land at Airport City 2 project site to Heaven Builders Limited in consideration for the provision of Airport City 2 infrastructure. The Ghana Airports Company Limited, GACL, is pleased to grant you an offer as the anchor developer for the Airport City 2 project following the expression of interest, submission mm-hmm. of documents, evaluation, successful selection, and approval of the project by the Ministry of Finance. Take note, approved by the Ministry of Finance. The offer requires you to provide the needed infrastructure for Airport City 2 in exchange for various parcels of land, amounting to the infrastructure cost of about $85 million. So you go through this offer and allocation letter, mm-hmm. and it's clear that Heaven Builders Limited has been asked to just come for this land, and they are to provide infrastructure.
Yes.
That's the consideration, mm-hmm. $85 million. Now, the fundamental question is, if Ghana Airport Company Limited mm-hmm. wants some infrastructure support or wants to carry out infrastructure works, can't it raise money on its own terms, on its own balance sheet? The Ghana Airports Company Limited did not need a middleman. They did not need this track recordless Heaven Builders Limited.
Why do you say that?
Because part three of my scandal exposés, I revealed that Heaven Builders apparently has no office. Mm. The office address they provided to official institutions, the Office of the Register of Companies, mm-hmm. and even the Ghana Airport Company Limited. When I went there, site 4, house number F17.
Is it the one in Tema?
In Tema.
Yeah.
An abandoned building.
Okay.
There was one squatter there who said, look, nobody has been here for more than 10 years. Mm. It's never been an office. I spoke to neighbors around, and they are shocked. So clearly, these scammers just identify this abandoned structure and then they put it in the
official
documents.
You cannot call them scammers necessarily.
They are scammers. I mean, since we started this expose, it's almost 2 weeks. Have you seen a single response? Not from the company. Interesting, they don't seem to care about their corporate image. Not from the Ghana Airport Company
Limited.
Have
you reached out to Ghana Airport Company Limited?
I am in touch with my sources. And remember that I'm waiting for Parliament to resume.
Okay.
And our motion has been drafted already. We are going to demand a full-scale inquiry, and we'll be summoning all of these officials.
Okay.
We want to summon them before a formal parliamentary setting.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's also important to emphasize that despite this outrageous offer, which conceptually is wrong, it lacks transparency, lacks accountability, it was done in opaque circumstances, no parliamentary approval. Would you believe that the Heaven Builders Limited had the effrontery on the 23rd of January 2023 to make a counter offer where they insist that the 38 acres is not enough for them? They want 62 acres. Can you believe that? And the lease period of 45 years is not enough for them. They want 99 years.
Because they pegged this at the value of the lands at the moment.
Yes. And that valuation they did, and I'm surprised they were allowed to do that, was so low, it was self-serving. And fortunately, and I must, on this one, I have to commend the managing director of the Ghana Airports Company Limited, who, seeing the overbearing influence of Heaven Builders and the cabal behind Heaven Builders, and let me emphasize that so far, I have discovered a link, a clear link. Heaven, those who are fronting for Heaven Builders are the same people who fronted for Frontiers, those who came to loot.
How did you settle on this link?
When you analyze the incorporation documents, you see similarities, similar addresses, similar witnesses. Then I've also spoken to insiders at the Ghana Airport Company Limited who have told me that it's the same people.
Okay.
Same people who brought the letters, who were, you know, negotiating, who were sitting in meetings, are the same guys. And it's linked to a Nigerian fugitive called Benedict Pictus, who really has been, you know, the shadowy character behind all of this state capture.
Are you saying this based on hearsay from your links at the Ghana Airport? Or
yes.
You
and,
have
and,
evidence
and,
to show?
And documentary evidence, yes. And
okay.
I challenge everybody, I'm willing to appear before any judicial process, any parliamentary process, and we'll prove it. And we've already published details about this. And so the same guys who engage in this Frontiers loot, where they took $10 for all of us, for the state, and allowed Frontiers to walk away with $140, a company that was incorporated on the 21st of July 2020, less than 2 months after the airport was reopened on the 1st of September. So no track record. Something that Noguchi could have done, KC Serial could have done, Kolebu Central Laboratory. They allowed this dubious entity to come and reanalyze, and our a very conservative estimate is that these guys, Frontiers, made over $130 million in profit. So it's the same cabal that is now behind Heaven Builders. And they have the effrontery, the audacity, the sheer temerity to say that they should be given 62 acres, 62.14 acres.
For the same value.
For the same value. Now, when you go through the offer letter, there's even no independent entity has even really valued the construction that they say they are coming to do, that infrastructure, roads, and all of that. So where did that $85 million come from? You know, some conjuring from the skies. Then you also have a situation where there's inherently no mechanism to really determine that they have actually spent $85 million and they will be given all of this land. Now,
but if you read the document, you realize the letter that Ghana Airports Company wrote to them, I mean, they gave some terms and conditions. And even after the first 6 months or so, if you don't start construction, et cetera, we're going to retrieve, you know, the lands from you and all that.
Yes, I'm talking about a mechanism to know that indeed they have spent $85 million.
Yes. Okay.
They should have built in this agreement an independent verification.
Okay.
You know, where the estimates, how much really you are pumping into this project can be independently assessed. You don't, so it is really based on what Heaven Builders say. When you read this agreement, it's so skewed, it is so one-sided, it's lopsided, it is just intended to really, as it were, guarantee the utmost interest of Frontiers and heavy builders and all those behind this deal, and not the Ghanaian people. Now, let me...
At what point did the Bridgewater Company also come in?
Good.
And the Ghana Institute of Surveyors?
Fantastic. So that's where I was headed to. So when the counteroffer was made and it became a contestation, and I must say that, you know, the management of Ghana Airport Company Limited is divided. This has divided the management, it's divided the board, and that's why we are getting a lot of information. Insiders are working with us, and they are patriotic elements. I must commend them. Look, that's why we passed the Whistleblowers Act. Every government, every time in our history, we need people, even if they are MPP members, who will say that, look, enough of the looting. We will put country's interests ahead of partisan or other narrow, you know, peculiar interests. So I must commend them. So they decided that, look, this is becoming a contestation. We are under pressure from Ministry of Finance, from the presidency, to go ahead with this transaction, to hand over these lands to heaven builders. So let's cover ourselves. Let's bring in independent analysts to look at this. So they decided to bring in Brightwater Investment Limited, a credible firm, to carry out their own independent valuation. Then they also invited the Ghana Institution of Surveyors. I have all those reports, and I've published same on my social media handles. Would you believe that all of them, not one dissenting, all two independent institutions said that this deal is a bad one. It's not in the national interest. We are not guaranteed value for money. They have even attached recent purchases. And I must commend the Ghana Institution of Surveyors. They did such a thorough job. They have even attached recent purchases that were made by Stanbic, for example, by Nestle. And you see a purchase where, for example, Stanbic is buying a 1.7-acre land close to that same vicinity for $6.3 million. Now, these heaven builders say that their valuation, $1.3 million maximum. They won't go beyond that. So you see a deliberately done knockoff to just beat down the prices, so that when they now, because they are calling themselves anchor developers, they are going to now be selling these lands, reselling the lands in the name of the development. And we all know who are those going to buy the lands at the end of the day. This whole scheme is state capture. Let heaven builders take the lead, go and then front, take the lands, and then they will just distribute it amongst cronies. That's what this is about. So I am glad, and I must commend the Ghana Institution of Surveyors and Brightwater Investment. All of them are unanimous that this counter offer should not be entertained at all, and that this project, this whole transaction, does not guarantee value for money. And I have presented those reports. The Ghana Institution of Surveyors cannot deny that they were invited and they have carried out this assessment.
I see the report.
Yes.
And I mean, Brightwater says that they recommend the offer of 40 acres to heaven builders as payments for the total cost of works for the installation. So they've even increased it a little per what Ghana Airport Company Limited was given to them. But you seem to use some very choice words to describe those you say are behind this business deal. I mean, ideally, this should also, again, go to court, should it not? If you have concerns about some of these things and you doubt that Parliament as well is on the side, it looks as if we talk a lot, but a lot of these people have not been brought to book, even though you've done quite a number of exposés.
Let me emphasize that as a member of Parliament, I must really exhaust my parliamentary opportunities. And all over the world, members of Parliament use the institution and the constitutional right to carry out oversight imposed on them to the maximum. And that's what I'm doing.
Okay.
I don't believe that initial stages you rush to cut another arm of government when Parliament can be well versed with these matters and can look into it. And that is why we always adopt the route of motions, inquiries, because the parliamentary, you know, institution is very powerful. If there is consensus and we all decide to really put aside the partisanship and put our country's interests first, you know, there's so much that we can achieve collectively. I mean, remember the Sputnik V, inquiry.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, very far-reaching recommendations made by Parliament.
What has happened?
Virtually both sides
what
agreed that this
health minister came out and said he wasn't thinking straight.
Yeah,
he's still at post. And so that's why we're asking that, yes, we see Parliament also, setting up committees to investigate.
Yes, but Bella, you cannot discount the fact that it was a helpful exercise. There were lots of revelations. Uh-huh. We now know a lot about all those shonky sheikhs.
And then what happened?
Who acted as middlemen.
Uh-huh.
This love for middlemen to just state capture. So the committee's report uh-huh. was presented, the uh-huh. House debated. What is outstanding is the vote
okay.
of censure.
Why has it taken so long?
Because, you see, there's a lot of behind the scenes, what is called the parliamentary discussions, negotiations, horse trading and all of that, which is really part of parliamentary jurisprudence. Because, you see, we wonder when the question is put, we will have some consensus.
Okay.
And, historically, it's been difficult cutting through this Chinese wall of extreme partisanship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
But you have equal numbers in Parliament
at the moment. And to succeed, we'll need two-thirds. So you certainly must, cross over and get colleagues on the other side to support you. And those are the kinds of discussions happening behind the scenes. But it's clear from the report that the health minister has been indicted.
Uh-huh.
It is clear. I mean, even the international community keeps asking us anytime we meet, why is your health minister still at post? Parliament should finalize the process.
Mm.
So I'm sure that when Parliament resumes, it's probably going to be one of those matters on the front burner.
You think that the other side will get your support? Or will give you their support? I mean, if you look at even how a number of them even came out and said they wanted the finance minister out, had a meeting with the president who says, let's finish our budget reading, let's also finish our deal with IMF, and then we can take a decision. Till date, the finance minister is at post. What's the guarantee that you'll get their support?
It's a fair concern, legitimate concern, and that's why I talk about this Chinese wall of extreme partisanship.
Uh-huh.
We are hoping that we can break through.
You're hoping?
We are hoping. We can only hope. But I believe that the day is coming where, because look, we've had a few in time past, the PC appeal forees,
mm-hmm.
and there have been instances where people have taken positions which have not really been, on partisan lines. I believe that day is coming where people will say enough is enough. Members of Parliament will listen to their constituents. And you see, it's also for our constituents to start demanding,
mm-hmm.
Whether it's a safe seat or not, let your MP know that, look, on these matters, look, we will punish you. There's a primary is coming. We will recall you. And we want you to vote in the national interest. So I believe that as our democracy matures and grows, and we deepen, this whole, democratic culture, I am sure that we will begin to see MPs voting on some of these critical matters in the national interest, putting that above the narrow partisan interest.
In the meantime, you're waiting for Parliament to resume sitting?
Yes. Our motions have been drafted. I've had meetings with the parliamentary leadership.
Okay.
I've also had meetings with the leadership of the Transport Committee. They are livid, really upset that all of these matters did not come before them. They have been engaging the Ghana Airports Company Limited. Never did they tell them that the airport lands were up for sale, and they had made this dubious offer to having builders who have the effrontery to be demanding, 62 acres.
Was it sole sourcing? I mean, how did they also arrive at giving this contract to Heaven's builders?
Brilliant question. So the whole procurement process itself is another scandal on its own.
Okay.
And it's something I was going to go to later. I've secured all the tender documents. And really, they were not, if you look at the credibility
mm-hmm.
of other institutions who took part in this whole tender process. Heaven Builders comes to look, this is a company
mm-hmm.
that has a stated capital of 5,000 cities. Can you believe that?
5,000 Ghana cities.
5,000 Ghana cities. One employee.
And
you are richer than Heaven Builders. You.
Sir, so you don't know how much I have in my account.
Oh, you are a renowned international journalist. We all observe you with pride. I admired what you did in France recently.
Thank you very much. But let's get back to this.
5,000 uh-huh. Ghana cities, the stated capital. Can you believe that?
And you say with one employee.
One employee.
Okay.
Their own declarations
mm-hmm.
at the Office of the Register of Companies. No office. Even the website that they put on the letterhead, all these counter offer they made, you key in the address, the URL doesn't exist. Even website, they don't have website. So you ask, what due diligence was done? What due diligence was done? This country, if we are talking about real estate companies, is this, look, and that's why this whole thing, there's no intention really to look for some credible organization to come and take up an $85 million consideration and be anchor developers. People just want to loot the lands.
But did they say how they were going to fund this project, the $85 million infrastructure project?
Brilliant question.
Brilliant question.
Look,
the document.
Once you get this offer, anybody who gets this offer can go and raise capital, can go and raise equity, can go and raise funding from the banks.
Okay.
So it's such a sweetheart deal. When we talk about sweetheart deal, this is classic sweetheart deal. That is why many analysts and experts are asking, why didn't Ghana Airport Company just raise this money if really they are in desperate need of $85 million? Because look, you just did this magnificent Terminal 3, borrowing on your balance sheet. Turkish contractors, international, you know, credit organizations were so impressed with your balance sheet. And you can't raise $85 million after that major Terminal 3 transaction. It doesn't make sense. It's clear what this is about. Great loot and share. People just want to own prime airport lands.
Are you not being unfair? Because, again, in your documents, you state the president, you state the finance minister as being behind this, when really there's no evidence pointing to the fact that the president is involved, the finance minister is involved. Yes, you do say that the names that have been mentioned in the documents for Heaven Builders is similar to what was mentioned in the Frontiers. But beyond that, we don't see the president's name there. We don't see the finance minister. You still refer to them as being behind this.
Oh,
is that not unfair to their person?
My dear sister, you were not listening when I was reading.
I'm listening, but that's why I'm asking that.
Is that
not unfair to their person?
Impression. I didn't introduce them. The Ghana Airport Company Limited, when they made the offer, they introduced them.
Okay.
And I read the first paragraph. It said, this project has received approval from the Ministry of Finance. It's here in the very first paragraph.
It's here. The president is there?
You mentioned Minister of Finance, President. So the finance minister is here. Who does the finance minister work for? You think that the finance minister can take such a major delegated personnel in government?
Okay.
Working for working for the president.
Okay.
And I know for a fact. I mean, and you see, that's why we serialize and that's why we come up with many parts. I know where the pressures are coming from. Do you know, I can probably reveal for the first time, that do you know that efforts are underway to do away with the managing director of Ghana Airport Company Limited? What I am tracking, I don't think she will be there beyond December.
You don't think so?
Yes.
Because she does not agree with this.
Yes, she's been accused of feet dragging and not, you know, because they wanted her to have signed off to this deal
long
ago.
So this deal has not gone through?
No, it's on the verge.
Okay.
We are on the cusp. Very, very, it's almost there. And that's why I had to blow the alarm. Because you see, sometimes people say, why don't you wait for it to go through? No, if you're acting in the national interest, when it goes through, it becomes very difficult. So how are we then going to retrieve these lands?
Okay.
It's always difficult. I remember 2009 when we came to power. Look, what we had to go through to retrieve some of the lands. Many people forget that where the foreign ministry is today had been sold out to private people.
Yeah.
And we had to virtually refund the peanuts that they were asked to pay for those lands.
Okay.
And today we have the foreign ministry there. So if you can stop it in its tracks, if you can stop the hemorrhage, do that. And the analysis I have done, a lot of the work we have done, we've saved this country 6 billion Ghana cedis so far with all of these exposés. And I think that has to continue. If you can blow the whistle in good time and you can stop these deals, it's better you do that. Don't wait for it to be finalized, for it to be consummated. And then you know what happens in this country with judgment debts. The parties will say, we had a valid contract. We had been offered the land. We even had started some work on the land. And you are trying to retrieve it. So you owe us judgment debt. Mm-hmm. A lot of the judgment debt we pay is because of some of these things. So you stop it in its tracks, it's always better.
Okay.
You save money, you prevent judgment debts in the future.
If the NDC should come to power come 2024, is this something you're going to continue?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Against your own people?
Absolutely, be rest assured, absolutely. Absolutely. You see, if people had followed some of us closely, even when we were last in power, it's not everything that we have agreed with. Even now, you recall that I had to leave the appointments committee. There are some of us who believe in being conviction politicians. Mm-hmm. When we feel strongly about a matter, we will stand up for it,
okay,
regardless of the consequences. It's always important that, you see, politics does not become some grand conspiracy by the political elite to engage in a lutocracy, to engage in pillaging and plundering. I mean, if that's what politics is going to become, then some of us, particularly we the young ones, do not want to be part of it. Look, there's so much that we can achieve as a people. These national resources, when you come into political office, are for the people, to benefit the people. Look at the suffering in the land. I mean, look at the level of desperation.
Mm.
And then we offer all of these deals. We engage in all of this inflationary pricing. See how much we've lost to that pit in the name of National Cathedral. See how much is going into so-called Bank of Ghana head office. And you read the Central Tender Review Committee's damning verdict, how they did variation without approval, started the construction without the approval, and about $300 million. Imagine what $300 million can do. I've told you that all of these exposés, we value them at 6.2 billion Ghana cedis. Imagine what that money can do. Mm. I mean, free SHS is just about 2 billion.
Okay.
You know, so imagine what about 6 billion Ghana cedis can do to improve the lot of our people, to even stop things like financial haircuts, where pensioner bondholders can have access to their life savings.
Okay.
I mean, so look, it's about developing our country. It's about improving livelihoods. It's about making Ghana worth living and not seeing the exodus. Have you gone to the airport lately?
Mm.
You see how Ghanaians are living in droves. I mean, I have had to introduce all kinds of new, you know, incentives in my constituency to attract nurses, to attract doctors, because we are losing them. You know, they all want to see greener pastures. And it's not really that people don't want to, because there's no place like home.
Yeah.
But when we make it so difficult, almost impossible to survive, certainly they will leave.
Okay.
So these decisions, bad policy decisions, decisions that are not in the national, because you see, if you have nothing to hide, why are you not first presenting a policy brief to Parliament? Let's all have a debate. Okay. We really don't need these lands anymore. We want to, bring in private developers. How should we go about it? Are we really sure that's in the national interest? I mean, should we preserve portions of it? If we want to do a Terminal 4 tomorrow, we want to do some more expansion tomorrow, because we've always known that even that whole enclave for the airport, it was more of a temporary arrangement. Remember that the major plan, if you look at the master plan for our airport, really, was that the main one will be sited in Pram Pram, in the Ningo Pram Pram constituency. That has been on the drawing board for a long time. So are we sure that we want to really offload all of these 93 acres? So these are matters that, if really it's not state capture, you have nothing to hide, you bring it to Parliament.
Okay.
Let there be a parliamentary debate. Let the Oversight Committee on Transport have an idea about this. Mm-hmm. Discuss it. Let the whole process be known by the Ghanaian people. You know, that is how, look, elsewhere, you even, everything to the core, every major project, even estimates, they are discussed, they are put out there,
mm-hmm.
who the contractors are. So you even have sometimes environmentalists. Heathrow, for a long time, Heathrow Airport expansion has come under enormous criticism, because environmentalists say that, no, Don't go ahead with that expansion. We don't even want the noise. We should even be ending all of this, you know, fossil fuel projects and all of that. And it's opened up for all kinds of discussion. So, you see, when a president promises us that he'll protect the public purse, that he will do everything to make sure that national resources are channeled into the development of the people, these are not the kinds of schemes that we expect.
We have to go, but finally, I just want to ask, has Parliament become weak, in quote, and I use that advisedly, which is why this government sometimes feels like there's no need to even go to Parliament and we can still sidestep them and conduct some of the transactions, that because we've seen quite a number of them.
Yes, I mean, you are right. Frontiers didn't have any parliamentary approval. National Cathedral did not have any
Should
parliamentary
we blame
approval.
Parliament as well for becoming a little too
chartered
weak?
Jets.
Barking more than they can actually bite?
As a member of that institution, so I'm torn. One breath, you want to defend the institution, its viability, its sustainability, its image. But you also want to be honest and say that, because some of us have even been frustrated from within. You know, how long it takes even for these matters to be addressed and all of that. So I think that it's time for an introspection. Mm-hmm. I think Parliament can be stronger. Parliament can be more, you know, efficient. But we are getting there, particularly for the first time having a speaker who is not from the ruling party.
All right.
I don't think that even the ongoing probe on the IGP will have been done. Remember that the speaker has approved a probe for National Cathedral. So I think we are getting there. We are making progress, even though it may be slow. But if you can allow me a minute to talk about my people.
Just a minute, please.
There's a humanitarian crisis unfolding in my constituency and in many parts of the Volta region and other regions where the Volta Lake, you know, passes through. The VRA announced that they were doing some controlled spillage, discharging water because the dam has reached its brim. That has led to a humanitarian crisis. As I speak to you, I can show you footage this morning. From my constituency, many communities from Mafer to Bato, Aveima, Kome, you know, Ngolikwe, and all of those communities are submerged as I speak to you. I think that it's regrettable and unfortunate that the VRA went ahead with this pillage without putting in place the right mechanisms, making sure people have, you know, relocated to higher ground and providing relief items and all of that. I don't know where NADMO is in all of this. So I'm rushing to the constituency from here, and I want to use this platform to call on all the authorities, VRA, NADMO, the Ministry of the Interior, the President of the Republic. This is a humanitarian crisis, and let's intervene quickly before matters get out of hand.
Thank you so much for speaking to us this morning. Honorable Sam Okudzeto Ablakwa, he's the MP for North Tong constituency, and he's also a ranking member on the Foreign Affairs Committee. In Parliament. Parliament resumes sitting.
In about a week's time.
In about a week. And so we're looking forward to how this Heaven scandal will be, you know, investigated moving forward and discussed on the floor of Parliament. But is your school winning at Kitchen Wars Grand Finale? Well, we're going to be speaking to Achimota School, and well, there are concerns that maybe they could win this year's edition. Could that really happen? Cookies coming with that conversation. Don't go anywhere.